Hello, everybody. I did just put a link in the chat box. There are a couple of, I like to, when I present, I always try to give you something to take with you. So we've got a couple of objectives, and the link will take you to some sheets that you are more than welcome to use to fill in your objectives. Totally up to you, but they're fun, and I like a good theme. So they're kind of themed with this teaching on two planes. Tell you a little bit about myself. I am an assistant professor of education here at Carson-Newman University. We are in the small town of Jefferson City, Tennessee. And I teach our future teachers. I teach educational technology here. And then I also am the program coordinator for our job embedded program, which is Tennessee's alternative pathway to licensure. I have been here for almost 4 years. Prior to that, I taught criminal justice at both the high school and the collegiate level. So made a little bit of a change, but I love what I do here. Love the people that I get to work with, and even in these crazy times, it has been a lot of fun. So my presentation, really, the idea for this came about as I've been talking with some of our students that have graduated and become teachers, some of my students that are in that job embedded pathway, who, bless their little hearts, they decided to start teaching without any knowledge of any kind of pedagogy in the middle of a pandemic. And they said, I just feel like I'm on the boat and building it. And I was like, you're right, except we're on a plane, because at least if we're on a boat, there's water to catch us when we sink. And I didn't really feel like we had a lot of water to catch us if we failed and started to sink. So that's where the idea for this came from. I feel like a lot of us maybe are even teaching on three or four planes as we've been trying to build them, but I limited it to two, and we'll try to hop planes and talk about how to hop those planes as we go. So like I said, I like to do objectives. I am an education teacher, so we do a lot of this kind of thing. So I've got two objectives today. One, I want you to begin to create a plan. A lot of you are going to already have a plan because you've been doing this, but maybe find some new ideas for your plan for teaching your students face to face and virtually at the same time. I know a lot of people, when we went back in a fully synchronous online format. We actually went back in a fully synchronous hybrid format. So we've had students in class, students on Zoom, students in quarantine, kind of all happening at the same time. And a lot of movement between those groups of students. So that's kind of our first objective. The second one is to create kind of three action steps to help engage your virtual and face-to-face students, both with the content and with each other. We know in education that students just learn more, they learn better, they retain more when they have built relationships both within the classroom and with the instructor. So we're going to talk a little bit about that and some ways that we can help them do that. So what I tell my students all the time is before we can fix something, we have to understand what we're doing. Okay, so we need to understand what we're going to fix. To me, there's kind of four steps in understanding this problem. The first is our students are flying on two planes, right? That some of them are doing education totally virtually. Some are doing face-to-face, and then we do have that hybrid mixed in for good measure. And for a lot of our students, this is the first time they've done this. They've never, we hear all the time because our university offers both online and face-to-face programs. And people that want face-to-face classes really strongly want face-to-face classes. And people that want online classes really strongly want online classes. So for a lot of students, this almost being forced to go one way or another due to school closures, pandemics, contact tracing, quarantines, all those kinds of things. That's an automatic change for our kiddos. Right. That was a change for our P12 schools. It's been a change for higher ed. Not only is it a change for them, it's a change for us. Prior to all of this, I have taught online asynchronously. I've taught face to face. Obviously, face to face is going to be synchronous. But I've never really taught a class that was both within the same class. What we found here, and I actually was like I said, I teach educational technology, so I was kind of the person in our department that was the go-to for help, is even with my experience, trying to fold the two together and trying to work through some of the problems that we were going to have, that we typically don't think of, right? Some of us have taught online classes before, but typically, if a student signs up for an online class, they have things like good internet access. One of the problems that we had was when students had to go home, not everybody had great internet access. I live in rural East Tennessee. We got lots of mountains, lots of trees. It's beautiful, but maybe not the best for internet access all the time. So we noticed that we were having a lot of problems with that with our students. So how do we continue to maintain rigor to make sure that those students are learning what they really need? Oh yeah, and balance that we're doing it both synchronously and asynchronously to meet everybody's needs. So that's kind of problem two. Problem three is that everybody is overwhelmed. I don't know about you, but there was a point about July that I just quit watching the news. Maybe that's just me, but I was done. I couldn't watch anything else. If I heard the words COVID, Corona, contact trace, or pandemic one more time, am I the only one? Was everybody like that? It was just a little overwhelming. Our students feel the same way. Oh yeah, then we hit an election. That was lots of fun, right? So civil. Everybody was using such kind words and being so lovely to each other. That was also a little overwhelming. We had changes to our whole way of life. Even some of the things that we take for granted. So my university, I was on the committee. We made the decision to skip fall break. We all thought it would be fine. What we didn't take into consideration was all of this emotional baggage that we were all going to be carrying. Now, I don't know about you. Oh my goodness, y'all skipped spring break too. Bless you. You got prayers because that it was rough. By the time we got to December, I was totally done. My body basically shut down. And it was a lot of emotional baggage. When we take those overwhelming emotions and combine that with the students are doing things that they don't really know how to do, we're teaching in ways we don't really know how to teach. Oh yeah, and a lot of those things that we tend to use as ways to blow off some steam to get rid of that stress. Gyms got closed. Football didn't happen in a lot of places. If it did happen, there were no fans, right? It was just a whole change to everything. So that is its own issue. And that was its own issue whether you were teaching 4-year-olds in pre-K or doctoral students. Across the board, everybody has had these overwhelming feelings, this overwhelming emotion. And then the fourth problem, and this is kind of a funny thing, but there is this book that is used in tons of teacher education programs, and it's excuse me, by Harry Wong. And I'm just going to tell you, there's no chapter in any Wong book that tells you how to do this in a pandemic. There's no chapter. Haven't found one yet. I teach, one of the classes I teach is Foundations of Education. I am now deliberately looking for a chapter for somebody to write in a textbook about how to teach in a pandemic. Haven't found it yet, right? We've been prepared to teach in storms, tornadoes. How do you teach with a fire drill? How do you teach with a lockdown, right? Did anybody get a chapter on how to teach in a pandemic when you have to randomly go online? Because if you do, I just need to know where that is, because I haven't been able to find it yet. So, you know, again, we don't really have any kind of direction for what, where do we go with this? Because it is different than just teaching an online class that started online. So I'm a planner. My family maybe thinks I overplan sometimes. Typically, that's when we go on vacation and I give them their folder with their itinerary and when we're doing what and where we're eating. Then they decide that mom has lost her mind. But I like to make a flight plan. If we're going to do this and we're going to teach in this strange, different way, I got to have a flight plan. And what I realized was, as I was trying to make these plans, I kind of had two big options. The first option was I was going to make this online flex hybrid way of teaching simulate the in-person experience. The second option was that I was going to use it and really differentiate my way of online engagement. Now, I will be the first to admit I ended up combining these a little bit, but there's a couple of things that I did that really not only helped me in class, but helped me to keep students engaged. So one of those is, and kind of the first one, is to have chat mods. Have any of you used chat mods in your class if you're doing classes online? It's a really great way to keep students engaged. For some of my classes, so a chat mod, it is where you have one person that's going to moderate that chat while you teach. So for some of my classes, they are what we call dually listed classes, meaning I have undergraduate students and graduate students at the same time. We're a small university. That way we can have the classes make, so nobody has to miss a class, that kind of thing. But we have to differentiate and add some for the graduate students. So what I quickly discovered was, especially in my educational technology class, as we were going to have to Zoom classes, because half of my class wasn't even going to be in the room due to social distancing or quarantine, it became very, very hard to try to teach and make sure that they could see my screen and make sure that the video camera was on and the microphone was working and watch the chat and still remember what I was trying to say. So I very quickly decided, hey, this is a good way for my graduate students to have something a little extra. So I had last fall, I had four graduate students in my educational technology class. And so they took turns being the chat mod. So what that meant was on their day, they would sign into the Zoom class from the classroom. They were sitting in the classroom with me. They would sign into Zoom, of course, keep everything muted so we didn't get feedback. But as I was teaching, one of the things that it was up to them to do was to watch that chat to make sure if somebody was having trouble hearing me, that we knew and could address it right then instead of waiting until I turned back around from the board. To make sure that it helped, that they could see what was going on the board, and to make sure that any questions got answered. Now, as far as extra incentive, in that particular class, it wasn't necessarily an extra incentive because these were grad students in a dually listed course. So that was part of their graduate student work that gave them the graduate credit. In another class that I did, Zoom jockey, there we go. I like that term. In another class that I have that's full of undergraduate students, it just became an expectation for the course that everybody would have to be the chat moderator, or I really like Doris's term of Zoom jockey, that everybody had to do that at least once. Now, I'm teaching future teachers, so that just became a piece of it. What I learned very quickly was having that opportunity that people could ask questions in the chat. I had students that would sit in my classroom and sign into Zoom and ask their questions that way. So what happened was a lot of those really shy students that don't talk a lot, that maybe they don't ask their questions, they were still contributing to the conversation. And it helped build kind of a bond within the classroom as they talked to each other and were able to respond and that kind of thing. So chat mods was one way that I really tried to simulate our in-person experience. In education, a lot of us in my department use a lot of group things where we are either grouping people who are seeking the same endorsement areas or the same teaching licenses together, or we'll try to group them based totally opposite to get people used to working and collaborating. So when we went online, all of a sudden we had this problem of half of my class was not even here for me to do group things, but the ones that were in front of me had to be 6 feet apart from each other. I don't know if any of you all tried a group project with everybody sitting 6 feet apart, but it got really loud really quick. So breakout rooms have been a kind of a lifesaver on that in-person experience, to just send everybody into a breakout room, even the ones that are there. That also allowed me to, because my classes were split and I had one group that was in person, so group A was in my room on Tuesday and group B was in Zoom on Tuesday. And then on Thursdays that switched. So I was able, using the breakout rooms, to do a lot of crossing those groups so that they got to know each other, even though they weren't all sitting in that same room. And then my other thing that I have used a lot to simulate in-person experience is interactive tools. My favorite has been Nearpod. I've also used Pear Deck. And the reason that has been one of my favorites is kind of twofold. A, I like the fact that I can just, if you've never used Nearpod or Pear Deck, you can put some activities within them, within your PowerPoint. Everybody has the PowerPoint coming up on their computer. They can go back and forth, engage with the PowerPoint, do the activities. It's a great way to, again, build that interaction across kind of the, I'm face-to-face, you're online, let's all talk together. But the other thing that I found really, really useful with Nearpod that was kind of one of those secondary thoughts. Yes, it does work in Google Slides. And Nearpod, it's Nearpod, the first one, Jen. And it does, if you pay for it, it interacts totally with Google Slides. If you use the free version, you can just put your Google Slides into it. But the other thing that I found was sharing a screen takes up a lot of bandwidth. And for a lot of my students, when they were at home in our rural areas, they didn't have that much bandwidth, or they were trying to Zoom from their phones. So when I could switch and use something like Nearpod, then they could hear my voice and just pull up what they needed to see on the screen, as opposed to pulling up everything. And it's made class go a lot quicker. We didn't have quite the lag time and the buffering that we were having with sharing the screens. Like I said, I use Nearpod. I've also used Pear Deck. There are lots of different options. That just happens to be one of my favorites. My second major approach was to go totally in an opposite direction and really use the fact that I was doing all of this online, all of these things, to do some really good differentiated online engagement. And this actually came from something that I used to do face-to-face when I taught high school. Everybody had a job in my class. My classes were grouped together. Everybody had a position. Everybody had a job. And those things got changed around. And one of the things that I have done to differentiate online engagement is to appoint discussion leaders. So I want that discussion, but I don't know about you. I get really tired of reading discussion boards where one person has answered and then 15 people write, "I agree. That's a good idea." Maybe I'm alone, but I really want more than "I agree" on a discussion board. So some of the things that I did, I assigned everybody in the class a discussion, and that they were the leader of. And some of the things that they got to do, that is not a response. And then I get 15 questions about, well, what is a response? You have to contribute something. But one of the things I allowed my discussion leaders to do was they really took ownership on that discussion about how it should take place. Okay. What I realized was this worked well, maybe not with first semester freshmen in college. I needed some that kind of knew the system, knew a little bit more about what they were doing. But it gave them the opportunity. In our LMS, some of them were like, okay, for this discussion, make a video. For this discussion, let's do an audio file. For this discussion, I want you to give me a picture. And I gave them some of that choice and let them, as they were leading the discussion, do that. And what I found was that allowing the students, I told them what the discussion needed to be about. I gave them the questions. But letting them take ownership of it, by the end of last semester, we had totally gotten rid of all the, "I agree, that's a good point. Nice way to put that." And we were really getting into some big discussions. And so I just asked them at the end of the semester, what changed? And they said, when I had to be the discussion leader and realized how awful it is to read 27 "I agrees," that changed my thought on how I should respond to a discussion posting. Now, for me, that's always what I'm going for. I want them to understand and to think through it. So that was a great way, helped differentiate. I was able to, because I did it in one of my upper level courses, I knew most of those students. So I was able to take and assign their discussions based on the things that I knew that they had a good grasp on. So my high kids on things about special education law, they led those discussions. My second way of differentiating is to use search masters. And this I also did the same way I was using chat mods. I would have search masters. You would think that when you're teaching future teachers, that the students that come in are all super excited and ready to speak in front of people, but they're not. A lot of people have to work their way up to that. Searchmaster is kind of my first step in working your way up to that. I start almost every class, every semester, with the admission that I don't know everything, but we're going to find answers to the questions that you ask. So I'm going to teach you a lot, but if you've got a question about it, we're going to find an answer for it. Because of that, that's where my search masters came in. Now, there are some times that I totally know the answer and I just have them, have my search masters go for it, just to get them involved and let them build that confidence that they can find the answer. But that's kind of how we use them. The search masters, if we had a question, that was part of their thing. They'd go and for the next class, they'd have us an answer. The way that this has really changed things. Yes, information literacy, huge. We learned a lot about where to find good answers. I've only now had to tell people twice this semester that things like Babylon Bee are not actually news sources or good sources to use for anything. besides a laugh. But what it also did, it got them thinking about the information. It got them working with the information. And it has built confidence for a lot of those really shy kids that, you know, at the beginning of the semester, they were like, I think I want to be a teacher, but I don't know. I may not be good enough or smart enough or whatever. It has helped to build their confidence because they realize, okay, no, I am. I can do this. I can find answers. I can answer questions. And then the third way that I've really spent a lot of time differentiating is in doing summaries and analogies that are reflective. So not just summarize what we learned, but instead summarize where you are on the knowledge scale of what we learned. Tell me where you want to be. Tell me how you're going to get there. Tell me what this is going to look like in your future classroom. Tell me how this relates to your life right now. How did this relate to your past 12 years of school? And really having them take everything we were doing and put it back in the format of what do I want to do with my life? You know, I have in my classes, I have everything. I may have 4 people that want to teach early childhood. And I'm trying to think of my ed tech class this semester. I've got 4 early childhood people. I have 2 chemistry. I've got 3 middle school math. I've got business. I've got a couple of English, some foreign language. It's just kind of a grouping, right? So what I've made them do is take everything we're learning and reflect back on what does this look like in your classroom? And then they have to share that with somebody that's in an area that's different than they are. So if you're special education, I want to know what does data analysis look like in special ed, but I also want you to share that with somebody in high school chemistry. And I'm trying to get them in that habit of building those relationships and this thing that we're not on an island, like none of us teach on an island, which seems to be sometimes hard for us to keep in mind. Because a lot of times, especially this past year, it has felt like we were on an island, all by ourselves in our little Zoom rooms, right? So that's been really, really helpful, is having them not only summarize, not only reflect, but start comparing. So a couple of things that I have found that have helped. First off, make it cohesive. So I've got a couple of quotes here. One is from Schwartz. When possible, use the same materials in both settings and stick with the same curricular progression. So this, I love this quote. I love the quote from Crook, teaching online and in the classroom simultaneously is a challenge, but using instructional strategies that reflect the educational design of the course can allow both sets of students to have a rich and robust learning experience. I cannot tell you how many people came in my office that were my job embedded practitioners back last August, last September, and they said, I'm just exhausted. And I said, well, what's going on? I mean, this is rough. We're all tired, but what's going on? And I said, I have to make everything 3 times. When I make a quiz, I've got to make the quiz on paper to give it to the students that are in my classroom. And then I've got to make the quiz we use Canvas. So in Canvas for my online students. And then I have to have another quiz to use for the students that missed because they were in quarantine. And I looked at him, I said, why are we making 3 quizzes? Let's make 1 quiz. Let's take what we want to do. Let's take what we want to teach. Let's take the way that we want to assess it. And let's create it 1 time that will work for all of those groups, right? In other words, let's have 1 map and send both planes down the same direction. just because your students are face-to-face doesn't mean that they have to do the assessment on paper. They could also use the same thing that you're building for those students that are online. It all has to work together. Because just like we're going to build things to bring our online students into the classroom, just like we want to imitate that classroom experience and bring them in and make them feel engaged, I also need the people that are in my classroom to be in the online experience. So when I say make it cohesive, don't kill yourself. There is no reason for us to be doing things three or four times. I don't know about you. I don't have time to do things three or four times. I do good to keep up with what I've got the one time. So that's been a major learning curve, to remember that, hey, if I'm teaching students face-to-face and online at the same time, they're all getting the same thing from me. They could all do the same assessment. They don't have to do different assessments. And that, if you want to talk about a time saver, that's one of them. To make things once and not 100 different times. If you're teaching three or four of the same class, trying to keep them in the same spot. Now, trust me, I get it. Sometimes one class gets ahead, one class gets behind. I totally understand. But keeping them in the same general spot, right? It would not make sense for me in two different educational technology classes that are the same sections of the same class for one of them to be talking about something like ISTE standards and the other one to be talking about technology concepts. Let's keep them both somewhere together. Okay. We're all killing ourselves to do this. So let's make life a little bit easier at least. All right. So let's talk about some strategies for engagement. My first big strategy for engagement is short videos, not big, long ones, short videos where they can see your face. If you're going to have them use a piece of technology or use a tool, just a little video that shows them how to use it that they could watch before class. Some of you have students, some of my students, they really need to know what we're doing before they get there. Now, will they all watch the video? No, they won't. We know that. They're not all going to listen when you give the directions either. But just give them some little short something, a handout with pictures that you don't even have to print it, just stick it in your LMS. A way for them when they have questions that they can see them, they can see the answers. What that does is it's helping to break down some of that barrier when the students don't want to ask the question. Because they look around and they feel like they may be the only person in the room that doesn't understand. Now, we know that they're probably not the only person in the room that doesn't understand, but to them, that's where they're sitting. So give them something, let them know what to expect, that kind of thing. Don't over-tech. I know that seems weird coming from somebody whose world is educational technology. Find 1 to 3 really, really good tech tools that you like, that you can use, that you're going to use with your students, you're going to teach them to use. Don't try to do all the tech tools, right? So one of the things that I found so interesting as everybody moved online is all of these tech tools became free. And everybody I knew was like, oh, I want to try this, and I want to try this, and I'm going to try this, and I'm going to try this, and I'm going to try this. And I'm like, you cannot try a new tech tool every single class period. Don't over-tech it. It's still a lesson before it's a piece of technology, right? We still have to start with what we want to teach. So the tendency is for us to over-tech it because we want to give the students all these different options and ways to engage and things that they can do. Resist the urge, 1 to 3 things. don't kill them with tech. logistically, when you're trying to teach and you have some students face-to-face and some students on Zoom, put the camera between you and your face-to-face students. A lot of people like to take the camera and they put it way back at the back. If you'll put your camera between yourself and your face-to-face students, then your virtual students have that feeling of being connected to you, like you are looking at them too. Now, if this is on your laptop, if it's, you know, a webcam, however you are using, whatever strategy you are using to get that information out, don't necessarily take it all the way back. We know that those students in the back row typically are perhaps not the best at paying attention to what you're doing. That's why they sit in the back row, right? It's really easy for that student on Zoom. And let's be honest, I'm sure some of us have done it. I've done it, I'll admit to it. To be sitting in a meeting and I have it running and I don't even have my video on. And I've probably got it muted because I'm working on something. When they can feel like they're closer to you, they automatically feel more engaged. They feel like they're having a conversation with you, not like they're in the back of a lecture hall that holds 200 or 300 people. And then my other strategy for engagement is self-care. And this seems like a weird one, but this is key not only for you, but for your students. Nobody, I don't think, please tell me if I'm wrong, I haven't met anybody that their idea of fun is to sit on Zoom for 8 hours a day and teach to a bunch of blank black boxes. Maybe I'm wrong. I'll admit it if I am. But that's really hard to teach to. Most of us don't want to sit on Zoom for 8 hours a day. Our students don't want to sit on Zoom for 8 hours a day either. Make sure you're taking breaks. Even if we're teaching an hour and a half class, guys, an hour and a half of just looking at somebody, having them Zoom, that's a lot. Take some breaks. I'm not saying we have to take a 15-minute bathroom break every hour, but just break some things up. If it's throwing a fun activity in, do that. If it's asking a random question, I like to ask random questions. When I have to do a full Zoom class, we'll get about halfway through and I'll ask some random question like, hey, you know, what football team did you cheer for last weekend? If we're in the fall and we have football. It could be something like, what did everybody have for breakfast? Something to break it up, something to make sure they're still working with you. They're still paying attention. They're still there. They're still awake, right? These are all important things. And what I found is for my students, they've gotten to where they look forward to those random questions. In fact, sometimes we ask the random questions and we keep going. And then at the end of class, they're like, your question today was kind of interesting. Can we talk about it again? Because sometimes the randomness is not quite as random as they think it is. Remember, they're people. That's easy for us to remember when they're sitting in front of us. That's a little harder to remember when they're all on Zoom and all we see is black boxes with names. Do some things to have fun. I do a theme. So last semester, one of my classes, we met on Zoom one day a week. The other day we were in person, but one day a week we were totally on Zoom. And so what I realized really quickly was I had a bunch of those little black boxes staring at me. So we decided to have a theme of the week. So every week there was a different theme and that they needed to put a picture up. It wasn't anything, you know, tremendously educational. It was things like, hey, what's your favorite breakfast food? Hey, this week, put a picture of you and your pet. This week, put a picture of your favorite sport. This week, put a picture of your favorite book. And what that did was that gave me another way when I would go to use those breakout rooms that I could group them together. But it also let some of those students that would have probably never spoken to each other face to face start to realize that they had more in common than what they thought. So that was something that worked out really well for them. I also am big on reminding them to take care of themselves. I don't know about you. I know when I get busy, I will just go and go and go and forget that, okay, no, you need to stop and eat lunch. We have students that will do that same thing. They'll forget, you know, hey, get up and walk around. Now, we did a challenge one week. If your watch tells you to get up and walk and you get up and walk, everybody that does it, every time their watch tells them to get up and walk, will have a prize, right? Guys, it was like a bag of chips. They're college students. They love food. That also worked when I taught high school. Food is great. It's a great motivator. A cup of coffee, anything like that. It didn't cost me a whole lot, but just getting them to get up and move, getting them to get up and walk away from their computer, that's a great thing. We did a challenge one week of every day this week, I want you to write, before you start anything, I want you to write 10 things you're grateful for. They don't have to be the big things, right? That's the Thanksgiving thing that everybody does, is they write those big, beautiful posts about what they're thankful for. This was little stuff, like today I'm thankful for coffee and twinkle lights and the air conditioner's on, right? It didn't have to be anything big. We did that for a week. What I started to realize was because I was pushing them to get back, we're always pushing them to get in the education zone. Sometimes we've got to push them back into, hey, you're a person, be a person. Like we don't have to just learn. It doesn't always have to be so serious. So that self-care piece was huge for them. As far as getting them not only to engage with the class, because they weren't so worn down, they weren't quite so tired, but also getting them to engage with each other. So, all right, so that's my whole presentation. I tried to give some time if you all have questions. I've also got, and this is, I'll post that link again in case you wanted the things that I made. You can reach me, I've got my email on there. My husband and I do a podcast for education called Perfect Chaos. It's a kind of a different take on education most of the time. So I've given you the website to that, my Twitter, my personal blog, my Facebook. I'm a pretty open book. I'll be glad to answer questions. If anybody wants the PowerPoint, you can just let me know and I'll be glad to do that and send it to you.
Yeah, Ronda, we do have a few minutes left. Do you want to open up the floor and see if we have any additional questions for you?
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. Doris, I see you want the PowerPoint. If you will shoot me an email, I will send you that PowerPoint.
And also, just for the information for all attendees here, Discord, sorry, I just lost a word. The Discord platform, there's a channel called Slide Decks, and sometimes presenters post links there too. So if you're interested in seeing what are shared, make sure you check that channel. That's just FYI.
Awesome. All right, Jennifer, looks like you're talking about your 3-hour face-to-face class. I will tell you, since I have started doing some of these things, I actually am using my online stuff also in my face-to-face. That the Nearpod piece is a great way to keep them engaged, or Pear Deck. Nobody sponsors me, so you can use whichever one you want to. I just like Nearpod. It has worked very well for me, but doing that even in a face-to-face class where it forces them to interact as we're going through, that would be awesome. I have not uploaded the PowerPoint yet to Discord. I can make a note and do that. I don't care to do that, Doris, but I can also, if you shoot me an email, I can email it to you.
And Ronda, if you want, you can also just email it to me and I'm happy to put it in the slide deck channel for you. Okay. Whatever works good for you.
Yeah, either way, I just had not gotten a chance to get into the slide decks. It's been a little crazy around here.
And Ronda, I just sent you my email address.
Okay,
in case
awesome.
You want to reach out to me.
Yeah, that'd be great. I'll send you that link as soon as we're done.
That's good. Did we miss any questions? I was watching the chat and I think people are jumping in and give responses. I was just thinking of something, Ronda, that you said about putting a laptop in front of you, like between you and the students. And so for your online students, it may seem like you are looking at them, right? That vision. There's also some products that you can put your iPad or iPhone as a slot and it follows you. So if you want to move around in a classroom instead of just, you know, standing behind a podium, that may be a good tool for you to explore. Basically you just wear like a necklace with Bluetooth and it talks to the little device and then you put your iPad or iPhone and you run a Zoom session or whatever platform you're using. So when you move around in class, it goes with you.
It follows you. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And those are great. We were, my university, the rule has been that we wear masks in the classroom, but if we're standing in one spot 10 feet away from students, then we can teach without them. So I have spent a lot of time right next to the board in my little bubble so that I can teach without a mask and then be able to hear me a little better. But yeah, definitely as we keep moving forward, to have the ability for things to follow you is great.